wounded heart. Take these tainted hands, wash me in your love. Come like grace again. Even when my strength is lost, I'll pray.
Morning. How are you? Good. I always rely on Ryan to get it wrong. Never mind, Ryan, you're right. It's good to see you in the flesh. We seem to be quiet today, but I suppose it is half term, isn't it? So that's all right. But if you've had a lion and not come in person, just, you know, we'll pray for you. It's good to see you all. We're going to be continuing in our book of Revelation. And we're into the, if you haven't noticed, we're already way into the deep waters of the book of Revelation now. So we're in the real weird bits. And I'm not going to lie to you, today's theme is all about suffering. So if you've come in a good mood, I aim to destroy it by the time you leave. I don't mean to do that. But it is, it's all about what do we say when we're going through hard times? Because they do come, inevitably. I always wish when I, you know, it's part of my job, is, as I'm sure you know, to go and sit with people who are in really difficult situations. And you always wish that you could just turn around and say, oh, God promises us everything will be great. But I can't say that because it's not true. And so what does the Bible say about what does it mean to be a Christian when we go through those really, really tough times when everything seems to fall apart and you're not sure you can carry on anymore? Say, God, I've depressed you all already. But there's what we're talking about this morning, because I think that's what our chapter's about. Although when we get to reading it, you'll think, what on earth are you talking about, David? What on earth has that got to do with suffering? But I promise you, we'll get there. Anyway, let's start with prayer, shall we? Let's pray. Lord God, we thank you that whether we are physically here or whether we're watching online, you are with us by your Holy Spirit. And we pray, Lord, that you would enable us now, whatever else is going on in our week, however hectic it may have been, or however much we've been alone with our thoughts, or anything in between. We pray, Lord, that you would center us on you now. Remind us that we are your people gathered in your name. And enable us to worship you afresh. In your name we pray. Amen. The Lord be with you, and also with you. We're going to start off again listening to a song. I'm hoping that in a couple of weeks' time we'll be allowed to sing. Everybody keep praying, all right? But as it is, sing along at home, and you have to sing twice as loud because we here aren't allowed to sing, so you've got to sing for us as well. But us here, we'll just contemplate the words. It's a very familiar song. The Lord's my shepherd, I will trust in you alone.
The Lord's my shepherd, I'll not want. He makes me lie in pastures green. He leads me by the still, still waters. His goodness restores my soul. And I will trust in you. And I will trust in you. For your endless mercy follows me. Your goodness will lead me. Guides my ways in righteousness, and he anoints my head with oil, and my cup it overflows with joy. I feast on his good delights, and I will trust in you, and I will trust in you, for your endless mercy follows me, your goodness will lead me.
Your goodness.
Yes, Lord, whatever comes our way, we pray that you would help us to trust in you alone and know that your endless mercy follows us now and always. Amen. We come to our time of confession. So let's just have a moment to bring to mind anything we particularly want to seek God's forgiveness for this week. We come to God as one from whom no secrets are hidden, to ask for his forgiveness and peace, saying together, Almighty God, long-suffering and of great goodness, I confess with my whole heart my neglect and forgetfulness of your commandments, my wrongdoing, thinking and speaking, the hurts I have done to others, and the good I have left undone. O God, forgive me, for I have sinned against you, and raise me to newness of life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And so may God, who loved the world so much that he sent his Son to be our Saviour, forgive you your sins, and make you holy to serve him in the world. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. As God's forgiven people, let's declare our faith together. So we say together in faith, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. We believe in God the Father, who created all things, for by his will they were created and have their being. We believe in God the Son, who was slain, for with his blood he purchased us for God, from every tribe and language, from every people and nation. We believe in God the Holy Spirit. The Spirit and the bride say, Come. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. Amen. We have another song, Never Once, by Matt Redman. Let's just contemplate the words together.
Standing on this mountaintop, looking just how far we've come, knowing that for every step you were with us. Kneeling on this battleground, seeing just how much you've done, knowing every victory is your power in us. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, yes, our hearts can say. Never once did you struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, never once did we ever walk alone. Carried by your constant grace, held within your perfect peace, never once, no, we never.
Yes, Lord, we declare that you are faithful. Lord, help us. And we're all in different places. We all come with different things going on in our lives, but I know there are people here and people watching who are going through unbelievably difficult times at the moment. And Lord, I pray for them that they would know your faithfulness. Know you with them, that they would know that never once do we walk alone. Come, Holy Spirit, and fill us afresh, even in the midst of hurt and pain. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Our prayer for today: God of truth, help us to keep your law of love and to walk in ways of wisdom, that we may find true life in Jesus Christ, your Son. Amen. A reading from Revelation chapter 11. Strap in, everyone. I was given a reed like a measuring rod and was told, go and measure the temple of God and the altar with its worshippers. But exclude the outer court, do not measure it, because it has been given to the Gentiles. They will trample on the holy city for 42 months, and I will appoint my two witnesses, and they will prophesy for 1,260 days, clothed in sackcloth. They are the two olive trees and the two lampstands, and they stand before the Lord of the earth. If anyone tries to harm them, fire comes from their mouths and devours their enemies. This is how anyone who wants to harm them must die. They have power to shut up the heavens so that it will not rain during the time that they are prophesying. And they have power to turn the waters into blood and to strike the earth with every kind of plague as often as they want. Now, when they have finished their testimony, the beast that comes up from the abyss will attack them and overpower them and kill them. Their bodies will lie in the public square of the great city, which is figuratively called Sodom and Egypt, where also their Lord was crucified. For 3.5 days, some from every people, tribe, language, and nation will gaze on their bodies and refuse them burial. The inhabitants of the earth will gloat over them and will celebrate by sending each other gifts, because these two prophets had tormented those who live on the earth. But after 3.5 days, the breath of life from God entered them, and they stood on their feet, and terror struck those who saw them. Then they heard a loud voice from heaven saying, "Come up here." And they went up to heaven on a cloud, while their enemies looked on. At that very hour, there was a severe earthquake, and 1/10 of the city collapsed. 7,000 people were killed in the earthquake, and the survivors were terrified and gave glory to the God of heaven. The second woe is past. The third woe is coming soon. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Shall we pray? Let's pray. Lord God, we do pray that as we continue to look at this amazing, but let's be honest, difficult book, that you would come by your Spirit and give us your insight. Give me your words to say, and anything that is of me, please discard. In your name we pray. Amen. So, we continue in our book of Revelation, and we're now, like I say, right in the midst of the hardest bit of it. One of the weirdest bits of the book, although it does carry on weird for quite a while, so don't think we're over the hump yet. And so I want to very quickly, and you'll forgive me for some of you that have been here before, recap how Revelation is supposed to be read, because it's important to carry on coming back to this and reminding ourselves, because if you're not careful, Revelation can be really badly misused, okay, by all sorts of... some of them well-meaning people and others of them not so much. But it can be a seriously misused book. So, start off at the beginning. The beginning of the book says, "The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave to him to show his servant what must soon take place." Okay, the word there for revelation actually comes from Daniel chapter 2, where Daniel has a dream, and he dreams, and we're told it's a dream of a statue that head is gold, and then silver, and then bronze mixed with clay. And we're actually told that this statue represents 4 different kingdoms, that it's not a literal statue, but the image is a symbol of these different kingdoms. And John is telling us, by using that word, it's a very specific word, that Revelation is like that. It's a bunch of symbols. And so it's really important that you get this, because if you come across interpretations of Revelation and tell you that it's all about weird kind of future prophecy about what's going to happen, literal descriptions of what's going to happen, then point them back to Revelation chapter 1, verse 1. Because the reason I interpret the book of Revelation symbolically is because I interpret verse 1 literally. Does that make sense? So if you want to interpret the whole of Revelation literally, you've got to ignore verse 1. Because verse 1 literally starts off by going, here's a bunch of symbols. This is a symbolic book that helps you to understand it. So you do get, Daniel chapter 2, that's where the word is used. So here's some kind of, in our chapter, you will come across interpretations like this. It talks about how there will literally, the temple will be rebuilt in Jerusalem, and a whole bunch of Jewish Christians will go and hide in this new temple that's been rebuilt. And then there'll be a third world war, and they will come and they will trample the temple, and these Jewish Christians will be safe in the middle of the temple. This is nonsense. And it's really dangerous nonsense. We know it's fairly fresh news. I mean, it's a week ago, and news moves on very quickly. But it wasn't that long ago that there were literal bombs going off in the Middle East. The site of the temple is the site of the Dome of the Rock. If we're saying that one day the Dome of the Rock is going to be destroyed and a new temple being built, that's a really dangerous thing to go around saying, isn't it? Think of how much damage that could do. So, you know, avoid these kind of interpretations because it's not a literal temple. In fact, it's really bizarre because these people then have to make the measuring of the temple symbolic. So they make the temple real and they make the 42 months real, but the measuring is symbolic. And you can see how they can pick and choose, and it just doesn't make sense. They talk about how verse 9, where the bodies of the prophets will be seen by all the tribes of the earth. And they say that's because there'll be TV and internet and they'll be able to live stream these dead bodies. This is the kind of, just if you read this kind of stuff, just ignore it. It's not, it's misreading verse 1, all right? And there's lots of others. I'm just going through it because you do hear these things creeping in and I want you to be alert for them, because if they're doing that, you need to be really, just, it's a dangerous book if you do that kind of thing. But that doesn't mean that we can make it mean whatever we want. Because again, real symbols mean real things. And in the first one, I looked at these political cartoons. I won't go through them again. These are old now. This was in the run-up to Brexit. And it's called Brexit Fools. And they've dropped their paddle. So it's up without a paddle. And you see Boris Johnson riding the boat. You don't have to agree with the political message of it, but this was in the run-up to Brexit and saying that he was leading us over Brexit fools. You can't make that mean Boris Johnson will appear on Have I Got News For You Again. That's not what the cartoon means, is it? And you can't make it mean that. It means something very clear. It's just not literal. If you look at that cartoon and you think it means Boris Johnson will one day captain a ship, you haven't understood how political cartoons work. This was another one I showed where, again, this was when France closed the borders because of the new, we call it the Kent variant. Everywhere else in the world calls it the English variant. That makes me laugh. Anyway, but they closed the borders to us. And you've got Britannia in the boat with the mask on, and you've got the COVID whirlpool, and they've got Union Jacks on, and it says Britannia rules the second waves, and all this kind of stuff. To understand these cartoons, you need to understand what's happening in the world, especially things like Brexit and COVID and France closing the borders and who Boris Johnson is. You need to understand some of the symbols. You need to understand who Britannia is and the Union Jack and the COVID symbol. Yep. And you need to understand cultural sayings like up creek without a paddle and Britannia rules the waves. But if you know those things, the cartoon immediately makes sense, right? And if you don't know those things, you'll look at it forever and not understand what on earth it's talking about. If someone in 2,000 years looked at those cartoons, would they have any chance of understanding what they're talking about? And that's where that's how the book of Revelation works. Okay, so to understand the book of Revelation, you do need to understand what's happening to the writer. Remember, this is a real person writing to real people at a real time with real things going on. You also need to understand the biblical background because he's using a whole bunch of biblical symbols, and you need to understand the common symbols of the day that they would have immediately understood, but we don't. And all them jammed together to create a picture that's like a political cartoon. Okay, sorry, that was a long introduction, but it is really important because that's how you understand the book of Revelation. Okay, here we go. Ooh. Revelation 11. First thing to say is that John is writing this book. He's a pastor and he's the elder, which we now translate bishop, although he wasn't a bishop in the way we have a bishop. He never wore one of those funny hats or carried a crook or anything like that. But anyway, he was in charge of a bunch of churches in a place that at the time was called Asia Minor, we now call Turkey. And he was writing. He'd been exiled to an island called Patmos for his Christian faith, so he was imprisoned. And he's writing this letter, this coded letter to these people. And they are suffering. They're going through unbelievably difficult times. They are being persecuted for their faith. They are being—they're not allowed to carry on with their livelihoods because of their faith. They're not allowed to sell things like most people are. They're not allowed—you know—they're going through really hard times, both because of their faith, but in other things as well. We know that there were two big earthquakes in Sardis and Philadelphia at about this time that destroyed homes. And led people, at one point they literally lived outside the city because they were scared of another earthquake coming that would destroy them. There was a big famine where people didn't have enough to eat. In 70 AD, remember this was written about 90 AD, there was the eruption of Vesuvius, which you may have heard of, which again sent ripples around the place. So they're not only persecuted for their faith, but there's suffering going on in the world. Plus, of course, you've got your regular stuff. We tend to forget that these are real people, but they are. People would have got ill. They will have lost loved ones. They will have lost husbands and wives or parents or children or whatever. They will have had businesses collapse and friends betray them and all the stuff that people still go through. That still would have happened to them, you know? And that's the kind of thing that they're going through. And so there's a suffering that's going on. And here's the thing, because what do you say to people in those situations? And there are two sets of things. You've got your one day Christ will come back and there'll be no more tears or anger or pain. And John says that at the end of the book and he hints at it in various other places. So yes, there's that future hope and we hang on to that and that's, you know, we'll get there, okay? That one day the earth will be redeemed and there will be no more tears or crying or hurt or hunger or pain. But how does that help us in the moment? Right? We know that, but in the moment of pain, when everything falls apart, what do we say in that moment? Telling someone it'll be all right one day is great and is important to hold on to, but it doesn't always help 100% in the moment, does it? And this, I think, when we get to Revelation 11, is John's answer to the question of what do we say to the people in the moment of pain. Does that make sense? Okay. So, what on earth is it all about? Here we go. I was given a reed like a measuring rod and was told, go and measure the temple of God and the altar with its worshippers, but exclude the outer court. Do not measure it because it is being given to the Gentiles. They will trample on the holy city for 42 months. Okay, the temple. The temple is a symbol, right from the early Christians, the very first Christians, the temple was a symbol for Jesus and for the church. Because the temple is the place where heaven and earth meet. So in John chapter 2, you'll be familiar with this, in John chapter 2, Jesus disrupts and knocks over all the tables in the temple. And they say, why have you done this? And Jesus answers them, destroy this temple and I will raise it again in 3 days. They replied, it's taken 46 years to build this temple and you're going to raise it in 3 days. But the temple he had spoken of was his body. You hear that? Jesus' body is the temple. Jesus is the temple. He's the place where heaven and earth meet. But that expands. In 1 Corinthians 3, 16, 17, it says this, don't you know that you yourselves, he's talking to Christians, you, individually this is, later on it's corporately, you yourselves are God's temple. And God's spirit dwells in your midst. If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy that person, for God's temple is sacred, and you together are that temple. Do you get it? The church is the temple. This is corporately and together, so in 1 Corinthians 6, 19 it says this, do you not know that your temple, your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you've received from God? You are not your own. That's individually. We together are the temple, but you, and you, and you, and you, you are the temple. The Holy Spirit dwells in you. Okay? And again, you get it in Ephesians 2. Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with God's people and also members of his household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. In him, the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. And in him, you too are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit. Sorry to carry on throwing it. I'm trying to show you how common this is. In this picture in Ephesians, we, the church of the temple, that's being held together by the chief cornerstone that is Jesus. Jesus is the temple, and because we are held together by him, we are the temple. Does this all make sense? Okay? And then you get it where 1 Peter says it, as you come to him, the living stone, rejected by humans, but chosen by God and precious in him, you also are like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house, a temple, to be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. So here, we're not only the temple, we're also the priests who work in the temple. I hope you see how all these images kind of work together. We are the priests who work in the temple, and we are the temple, and Jesus is the temple, and we're all held together, okay? That's what's kind of going on here. More than that, oh, there you go, I've just gone through these passages, there you go. More than that, it's used in Revelation itself. Elsewhere in Revelation, Revelation 21:22, I did not see a temple in the city. This is the image of the future new creation, the new heavens and new earth. I did not see a temple in the city because the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb, that's Jesus, are its temple. God and the Lamb is the temple. In Revelation 1:20, it says this, the mystery of the seven stars that you saw in my right hand and of the seven golden lampstands is this. The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven lampstands are the seven churches. The lampstands were in the temple. You had a lampstand in there that represented the presence of God in the temple. So when he says that you are the lampstand, he's actually saying that you're a temple. Okay? This is in the book of Revelation itself. The church is the temple. Jesus is the temple. You get the idea. We're also the priests. Hold all that together. Right, okay. 1:6, we've done that. Right, anyway. Oh no, the 1:6 one was, and he has made us to be a kingdom and priests to serve his God and Father. To him be glory and power forever and ever. Amen. We're the priests. Okay, you got all that? Have I convinced you yet? This is the Bible image. The church is the temple. Jesus is the temple. We are the priests. This is how the temple... So when he turns around and talks about the temple, any first century Christian would go, oh, that's the church. You just immediately know that. Okay? So here we go. I was given a reed like a measuring rod, and I was told, go and measure the temple of God and the altar and its worshippers. So in other words, go and measure the church. Go and measure us. And measuring was also a symbol of protection. Once you've measured something, it's like building a wall around something. But exclude the outer court. Do not measure it because it has been given to the Gentiles. They will trample on the holy city for 42 months. I'll just quickly mention the 42 months is 3.5 years. Just hold on to that. We'll come back to it later. Okay. The inner court in the temple, the Jewish temple, was the Holy of Holies where God dwelt. And what essentially the image is that the Gentiles symbolize the people who aren't God's people, if that makes sense. They may come and they may hurt you and they'll do all sorts, but they can't get to the core of the fact that you're the temple. In other words, this is a symbolic way of saying, whatever happens, whatever comes along your way, whatever trampling happens to your body, to your circumstances, no one can take away the presence of God that is within you. Are you with me? No one can stop you being the church with the Spirit of God in your heart of hearts. Whatever else comes your way, God's presence will never be removed, and it can't. It is protected. God is with you always. That's the symbolic image, and I know I've taken a long way to get there, but I hope you're with me now. You are the temple. And while the outer courts of the temple, While your faith may take a battering, no one can penetrate the Holy of Holies because God's Spirit is with you regardless. Do you get the image now? That's what's kind of being said here. We will suffer, but God's presence and God's spiritual protection is guaranteed. That doesn't mean you won't get cross with God. Go read Job, go read the Psalms. You're allowed to yell at the heavens. God's big enough to take it. If you're angry with God, let him know. He won't mind, all right? It's not to say that it won't be unbelievably difficult and hard and you won't think, why have you forsaken me? You may get to that point, Jesus did. But despite all of that, even if you feel like it, God's presence will be with you. You are spiritually guaranteed it. They cannot penetrate the Holy of Holies at the center of the temple. That's the image, okay? Right, okay. I'll speed through the rest, I promise. So what's the result of all this? The result of this is if you can hold on to that, if you can hold on in the midst of suffering and pain to the fact that God is with you, if you can remember that and know the guarantee, and sometimes you'll forget it, but God is still with you, but if you can hold on to that truth, then this passage says it's an amazing witness to God. It enables you to witness in a way that you can't any other time. And that's what this next section is about that I promise I will go through pretty quickly, probably. Right. Okay, no, we will. Right. And I will appoint my two witnesses, and they will prophesy for 1,260 days. That's 3.5 years. Again, remember that. I'll come back to it. Clothed in sackcloth, they are the two olive trees, remember that, and the two lampstands, and they will stand before the Lord of the earth. Right. In Zechariah 4, that quote of they are the two olive trees, that's a quote from Zechariah chapter 4, and in it, the two olive trees are the priest and the king. The priest and the king. And the priest represents... They represent the leadership of the whole country, the whole world, okay? So in other words, the priest is the head of, if you like, the leader of the religious part of life, and the king is the leader of the political part of life, although they didn't divide it in the way that we think of it now, but anyway, that's beside the point. In other words, so David is like the king, but then next to him you have Samuel, who admittedly wasn't the priest, he was the prophet, but that's the image that we've got. They were leaders together. And so when you witness, you are witnessing to God's presence in the whole of life. Okay, so it's not two literal witnesses, it's actually that you will represent God's witnesses in the whole of life, the political realm, the spiritual realm, the whole lot. Okay, if anyone tries to harm them, fire comes from their mouths and devours their enemies. This is how anyone who wants to harm them must die. They have power to shut up the heavens so that it will not rain during the time they are prophesying. And they have power to turn the waters into blood and strike the earth with every kind of plague as often as they want. Okay, this is a very symbolic way of saying they're like Moses and Elijah. Okay? If you're familiar with the stories, Elijah calls down fire from heaven. That's the fire out of his mouth thing. And it's not literal fire out of his mouth like a dragon. We'll get to the dragon later. That's later on in Revelation. But this, the fire, it's like the sword out of the mouth of Jesus earlier on. It's the word of God. Later on, it'll talk about them being brought up on a cloud. That's Elijah again. The sending of plagues is Moses. The turning of the water into blood is Moses. In other words, they're using different images of Elijah and Moses to kind of say it's like them. And what they're saying is when you witness like this, you are joining in with a long tradition. Moses and Elijah both stood up to corrupt political powers. With Moses, it was Egypt, and with Elijah, it was King Ahab. Yeah? That's why they're picked. And the early Christians, of course, are against, they're not against, but are being persecuted by the Romans. Okay? So it's like you are joining in with, when you suffer, you are suffering like Moses suffered. When you suffer, you are suffering like Elijah suffered. Okay? Right. That's the image here. You were joining in. When you were witnessing in the same way that Moses and Elijah did when they kept going, even though it was hard and difficult. They were being persecuted for it. Now, when they finish their testimony, the beast that comes up from the abyss will attack them and overpower and kill them. That's from Daniel 7. In Daniel 7, the beast is an ungodly nation making war against Israel. Again, it's a complicated passage, but just the beast represents a corrupt power, if you like. So Revelation is about the world making war against the faithful church. That's the image that's going on, okay? Whew, the bodies will lie. Are you exhausted yet? I hope you're still with me. Right. The bodies will lie in the public square of the great city, which is figuratively called Sodom and Egypt. They're the two most corrupt powers. Do you remember Sodom that was destroyed in Genesis? And Egypt was where Moses and that escaped from, and Pharaoh wouldn't let them go. They're the two kind of most corrupt places, where also their Lord was crucified. So now that's Jerusalem, and how the leaders of Jerusalem got together to crucify Jesus. For 3.5 days, some from every people, tribe, language, and nation will gaze on their bodies and refuse them burial. In other words, they'll gloat over Jesus' death and think they've won. The inhabitants of the earth will gloat over them and will celebrate by sending each other gifts, because these two prophets had tormented those who live on the earth. But after 3.5 days, the breath of life from God entered, and they stood on their feet, and terror struck those who saw them. They're resurrected. They die, everybody gloats and thinks they win, and then they're resurrected to new life again. This should remind you of someone, people. All right? Then they heard a loud voice from heaven saying, "Come up here," and they went up in heaven in a cloud, that's Elijah again, while their enemies looked on. In other words, yes, when we suffer, we are like Moses and like Elijah, but guess what? We're also like Jesus. That's the point that's going on here. And at the very hour, there was a severe earthquake and the tenth of the city collapsed. 7,000 people were killed in the earthquake, and the survivors were terrified and gave glory to God of heaven. The second woe was past. The third woe is coming. Okay, whew. Let's just take a moment. In other words, when you suffer, you are joining in not only with all the people that have gone before you, like Moses and Elijah, but you are also joining in with the suffering of Jesus himself. Okay, are you with that? That's why, for example, Paul can talk about how in his suffering, he is making complete the suffering of Jesus. And you think, what? What's that about? Not only Jesus can bring about salvation and atonement and all that lot. Of course, only Jesus can do that. He is the one who comes at the culmination of the ages, as the writer to Hebrews says. He is the one, the blood of the Lamb who cleanses us for himself, as Revelation has already said. But there is still this image throughout the New Testament that when we suffer, we are entering into the very ministry of Jesus himself. That's why the main call that Jesus says is take up your cross and follow me. It's not an easy call. Take up your cross and follow. That when you are suffering, you are in some way taking the pain of this fallen world upon yourself, which is what Jesus did, right? That's what all these 3.5 year bits are about, by the way, because the tradition was that Jesus' earthly ministry lasted 3.5 years. Told you I'd come back to it. Okay? So it's saying, this whole chapter is saying, when you witness in this way, you are joining in with all the people of God that have gone before you and joining in with Jesus himself. You are suffering, but you are suffering in a cross-shaped way. Are you with me? This is the point. And it's not an easy message. I'm not saying, oh, you know, well, hallelujah, we get to suffer in a cross-shaped way. Woohoo! What I am saying is, in that midst of that suffering, which will inevitably come, I hope you can hang on to the fact that is part and parcel of being the people of Jesus, the body of Jesus, the temple of Jesus in a fallen world. And God is with you through every single moment of it. And the last verse where it talks about how, what did it say? In that very hour there was a severe earthquake and a tenth of the city collapsed. This is just a very revelation way of saying, at the end of the age, we too will be resurrected and there will be a judgment and every knee will bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. That justice will be done. Again, we don't like to talk about that in nice modern 21st century church, but it's right there in Scripture. I've obviously gone on too long. Dog's giving me the hints. Right, okay. So when we suffer, remember, and this is the point, God will be with you in it. And we are like the people who have gone before us. We are entering into the suffering of Jesus and it witnesses in a particularly powerful way. You see this all the time. And when you do, every time it hits me. Every time it gets me. You see it in Scripture. If you go read the book of Job, the beginning of Job is almost comical. It genuinely is. There's this bit where all his barns are destroyed and all his animals are destroyed and all his children are killed and all his crops are just burnt and all the, and it happens one after the other. And they run and they say, and everyone, I'm the only one who escaped to tell you. And then when it all happens and he's lost everything and even his wife is turning around and going, why are you holding on to your integrity? Just curse God and die. I mean, that's a real encouragement from the missus there. And Job, it says this, at this, Job got up, tore his robe, shaved his head. Then he fell to the ground in worship. And he said, naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked I will depart. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. May the name of the Lord be praised. Can you imagine being able to do that when everything collapses around you? It seriously almost brings tears to my eyes when you stop and think about it. Everything collapses. The Lord gave and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. God, that's hard. I remember a while ago, do you remember there was a white fundamentalist Christian, that seems like an oxymoron to me, but anyway, never mind. They went into a black church in America and they shot a whole bunch of people, do you remember? And the next day there was this amazing woman on the news. Her husband and her son had both been killed. And she stood there and she said, I pray for him, I forgive him. God. Oh. I don't know whether I could do it, but to say that's a powerful witness doesn't even come close, does it? That's what this chapter's about. How God will be with you, and if you can hold on to that, it witnesses in a way that nothing else can. I remember when I was at university, one of our lecturers there, his wife had been murdered and his son had taken his own life. And he came and he spoke to us and he spoke about how he forgave and the importance of forgiveness and how he'd been and he'd seen his wife's murderer and forgiven him. And how he'd originally been very cross at his son, but he forgave him and he loved him. I was 18, 19? I didn't know a thing. I still don't, but you know, at that time I thought I did. That's the difference. And I just remember being bowled over. Absolutely bowled over. How do you get to that point? Naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked I depart. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. May the name of the Lord be praised. That's Revelation 11. God will be with you no matter what you go through. And know that you are entering into the very suffering of Christ and to what the people of God have done throughout the millennia. And know that if you can hold on to that truth, you witness to the kingdom of God, the new creation, in a way like nothing else can. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we don't pretend for a second that this is an easy book or an easy message. We don't pretend for a second that we want suffering. And Lord, we do pray, may, if possible, take this cup from us. But Lord, if and when suffering comes, may we somehow hold on to the fact that you are always with us and nothing can take you away. May we hold on to the fact that you, when we suffer, we are joining in with what the people of God have done throughout the millennia. We are literally taking up our cross and following. And may we have in you, because only in your power is it possible, the strength to witness in a way like nothing else can. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, we pray. Amen. We're going to listen to another song. It's well known, Blessed Be Your Name. And it uses those words from Job. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I turn back to praise. And when the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name when the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name on a road marked with suffering, though there's pain in the offering. Blessed be your name. Blessing you pour out, turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name, Jesus. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
come to our time of prayer. And I'm going to leave space during this. And instead, I'm just going to say topics, and I invite you to pray in your own words, in your head, as we go through. We've got a lot to pray for, so get to your point quickly as we go through these different topics. So let's pray. First of all, I invite you to pray for the world. Pray for the continued situation with COVID. Pray for the climate crisis. Pray for those struggling with extreme poverty. Pray for those with extreme wealth. Pray for the increased political polarization in our world. And maybe there are other things in the world that you want to bring to God now. We pray for the worldwide church. Pray for our church leaders. Pray for persecuted Christians. Pray for churches emerging from lockdown. Pray for the outreach of the church. Pray for the church's social work it does in its communities. Pray for the church in the declining West as numbers shrink. Pray for the churches that are growing in many other parts of the world. And if there's anything else you'd like to pray for the worldwide church, pray for that now. Pray for the UK. Pray for pray for our political leaders. Pray for our media leaders. Pray for our financial and business leaders. Pray for our hospitals. Pray for the world of education. Pray for the people in our country without jobs or who are fearful for the future. Pray for our elderly. Pray for our young people. And again, maybe there are other things about the UK that you wish to lift to God. Pray for St. Catherine's Church. Pray for our church family. Pray for our church staff. Pray for our elderly daycare service, which reopens tomorrow. Pray for our food bank. Pray for our Meals on Wheels service. Pray for the employment of a children and young people's worker that's currently being advertised. Pray for the new AV equipment, which will hopefully be going in the next couple of months. Pray for the continued reopening of church, things like being allowed to sing and have coffee together. Again, there may be other things about St. Catherine's you wish to lift to God. Pray for your own loved ones. Pray for them to know Christ. Pray for healing, physical, mental, or spiritual. Pray for your loved ones who are going through difficult situations. Give thanks to God for positive things. And again, if there's anything else, bring that to God now. And finally, I invite you to pray for yourself. Pray for the things that are troubling you. Pray for you to know Christ's presence with you. There may be something you wish to pray for healing about, again, physical, mental, or spiritual. Pray for any particular situations you're going through. And again, if there's anything else you want to lift to God, do so. So, Lord God, we pray for the world, for the worldwide church, for our own nation, the UK, for St. Catherine's Church, for our loved ones and for ourselves, and all the prayers we have spoken, we lift them to you and ask them in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Rejoicing in God's new creation, as our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Okay, as we come to communion, for those of you who haven't done it or need a refresher, when it comes to communion, stay where you are. We will bring communion to you. If you you hold your hands out, I will dip the wafer into the wine and give it to you. If you just want bread and don't want wine, please do just tell me when I get to you. Or if you don't want to have communion at all, please again just say so and we'll move on. That's no problem. Okay, let's have a moment. Jesus prayed to the Father for his disciples, saying, "May they be one, as you and I are one, that the world may know I sent you." Typical. We say together, Almighty God, through the sacrifice of your Son Jesus Christ, you have revealed for us the way of eternal life. Sanctify us in your truth and set us free to serve you in humble praise. On the night before he died, Jesus had supper with his friends, and taking bread, he gave you thanks. He broke the bread, gave it to them and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When supper was ended, he took the cup of wine and again he gave you thanks. He gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me.
Deep world.
We say together, Merciful God, you have called us to your table and fed us with the bread of life. Draw us and all people to serve your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. You can go now. Notices. For those of you who can't read it, it says, a pastor, a priest, and a rabbi walk into a bar. Made me laugh. Right. Notices. First of all, surely most importantly, we've got some banns of marriage to publish. So Chloe and Robert, who are at the back, are absolutely thrilled to welcome you. We're going to do the banns and then we'll pray for this couple as they prepare for their wedding. May God have mercy on your soul. No, I'm joking. But I have a terrible sense of humour. I apologise. Right. Oh, David. It comes out of my mouth sometimes before I have a time to think. Let's... Oh, dear. Okay, so I published the banns of marriage between Chloe Hart, single of this parish, and Robert Bloomfield, single of this parish. This is the third time of asking. If any of you know any reason in law why these persons may not marry each other, you are to declare it now. Let's pray for Chloe and Robert, shall we? Let's just pray. Oh, God, I do lift this couple to you, and I thank you for them. I thank you for the love that they have found together. And Lord, as they prepare for their wedding, we pray, Lord, that that would be a real blessed day together, but also it would be the start of an incredible married life together. Lord, fill them with your Spirit. Bless their days, weeks, months, years, decades together. May they, in their love for one another, show what love looks like to the world. I lift them to you. In your name we pray. Amen. God bless, guys. Hope it goes really well. A couple of other notices. First of all, I ask you all to continue to pray for the school's children and young people's worker that's being advertised. The deadline for that is the 16th of June, and then we'll be in, 16th of June, and then we'll be interviewing for that at the end of June. So hopefully we'll have someone to start in August ready for the new school year. So that's a really exciting development. So I do pray for all of you to continue to pray for that appointment. You'll also have heard last week, I hope, happy news for him, but sad news for us, that Andrew has got a new job. He's going over to Ossett, and he's going all the way to Ossett, miles and miles away. I know, but he won't be here every week. Anyway, I had to laugh that when we found out, I had to get Kathy, who we work so well together, the three of us, and she went, I'm really pleased for him, but I'm going to miss him. And I was like, yeah, but we knew this day would come. It was like we were parents letting go of our child. It was awful. Anyway, we wish Andrew all the best. The reason I mention it is that his last Sunday with us will be the 25th of July. Okay, so try and be here for the 25th of July. That's going to be our last Sunday with Andrew with us. He's going to be sharing with us. He's on holiday this week, but he'll be back 25th of July. I'm hoping that restrictions will have lifted a bit by then and we'll be able to do some more stuff to send him on his way well. But obviously we have to wait and see what the restrictions and stuff are. So just continue to pray that restrictions lift, eh? Because it would be really nice to be able to properly mark his last Sunday, wouldn't it? And I'd feel a bit disappointed if we couldn't do that. But anyway, if we can't do it, we'll have to have him back one Sunday, won't we? It's not far away. Anyway, regardless, the 25th of July, put that in your diaries, because that'll be Andrew's last Sunday with us. The only other notice I do want to give is Musicians, first of all, I want to publicly thank, I've said this in various groups, Lynn, who has led our worship for 40 years. I'm just pausing at that because I feel that needs recognition. Thank you. She's decided the time has come for her to stand down from that role. She's still part of our church family. She's still going to be with us, but she's not going to be leading the worship group anymore. And as such, I am on the lookout for musicians. So if you have any musical talent that you are hiding your light under a bushel, now is the time to let yourself be known. Because hopefully in the next couple of weeks, we're going to be able to sing again. And we don't want me doing everything on my guitar. Besides, I need a new guitar string anyway. And I can't be here every week anyway. So it'd be really good if there are people out there and you feel that you could do this. I mean, I'm not going to put any pressure on anyone. But if there are people out there who could do this, please let yourself be known, because we're after new worship leaders. And indeed, if you don't want to be a worship leader but you want to be part of the band, let us know. You know, we're open. Okay, so there you go. I wanted to put that out there as we're looking for that, and do pray for that, because I don't know about you, but I've really struggled without music. More than anything else, I've struggled without being able to sing. It's such a central part of my spirituality, walk with Jesus, whatever you want to put it. It's such a central part of it, and so I've really missed it. So having a worship leader is a really key role. So do pray for that. And I do publicly, like I say, thank Lynn. She's amazing. We give thanks for her 40 years of service with her, with us. Howard is continuing to play, but he doesn't want to do it every week. He doesn't want to lead. And by the way, he's been leading worship in churches for 60 years. It's not a competition, but we thank Howard as well. I just thought I'd mention it as well. They're both amazing. Thank you. Anyway, we're looking for new people. There, that's all the notices. So, final blessing. May Christ, who out of defeat brings new hope and a new future, fill you with his new life. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you, and all those you love and pray for, this day and forevermore. Amen. Go in the peace of Christ. Thanks be to God. Amen. Please only move when we ask you to, but do go in a minute.
You are my rock in times of trouble.
You are my
He is.